We found that the best indicator of the next 30 days is what's happened over the last 30 days. So we're constantly using data to drive our business and using, you know, looking at heat maps, you know, workloads, and ensuring we have the right level of staff on at all times to handle the right level of work volume that we're seeing.
We perform multi-service and multi-signal investigations through our SOC investigation workbench. Our analysts are actively working quickly to determine whether something is malicious, and when they do find that positive indicator, there's that sense of urgency that a customer is under threat. We have a platform where we build out enrichment content, enabling analysts to create enrichments based off of things that we're seeing commonly for certain detections, as well as just helpful enrichments to get to an answer faster.
Due to the maturity of SOC and how long we've been around, we have an extensive global deny list that will stop the vast majority of threats before they even make it to us, so we can focus our time on the more high-ticket items and the big incidents.
You know, we're actively researching threats found within clients' environments, and we're applying that telemetry that's been made available essentially to our entire client base.
If we see the first step, but it doesn't quite match the first step, or we have reason to believe the client's doing this normally, or it's reasonably benign, then it might be a suspicious is sent, and then it's sent out and we get a reply once the client is available. If we were able to find the first step of, say, like this case where the activity was like discovery of their network, that would be immediate for us to get onto them to let them know this is happening and we need to know from you right now if somebody's meant to be looking at your network. But for the process of investigating, a lot of the time, that first step you find, you then are spending the few more minutes to try and find the four others that are coming after that or before that. And it completely can change how your verdict is.
In some situations, the SOC will reach out to us with an emerging incident. So sometimes they may see an influx of detections from an endpoint software. They'll give us a quick rundown on what they're seeing and what it looks like to them. And we'll take the reins from there and start doing our initial triage and figuring out what's happening within the environment. As part of that, if we find ourselves overextended during the course of an incident, we'll pull in our threat response unit during an incident to help analyze some of the artifacts or malware samples that we may have obtained.
When an incident takes place in a customer's environment, we're learning from that. We're creating new detections, blocking indicators of compromise, and ultimately getting to a stronger detection for our customers down the road who are involved in similar types of incidents.
So to be a successful SOC analyst, you need dedication, you need attention to detail, you need to be very passionate for the industry, be always willing to upskill yourself as it's an ever-changing environment.
We're all forensically trained and we are excited by chaos. One of our favorite things to do is investigate a ransomware situation or an intrusion and really just figure out how that started and what happened during that incident.
What I found is that there is a consistent trait among these people, and that's one, ownership and responsibility. And we're often at the leading edge of detection capabilities. Like some of our threat researchers I know are essentially naming malware strains because they're first detected within our client environment.
It's always important to maintain constant contact with a customer, especially during an incident. We want to make sure that our communication is clear, crisp, and effective, and that everybody involved is on the same page all the time and actively working towards a solution on that incident.